And we are live. Welcome everyone to ThinkYoung's webinar, one of a long series we're doing, and especially this one with a focus on inventors and European inventors in partnership with Ericsson. As you know, this is a campaign and a topic dear to our hearts, and inventors are definitely dear to our hearts. Since a couple of years, ThinkYoung is trying to put a light on the hidden inventors that had an impact and are having an impact on our life. And our special guest today, Professor Elvira Fortunato, definitely one of the most prominent European inventor today. She's a vice rector of Nova University in Lisbon, director of the Materials Research Center, the CENIMAT, and she's mostly famous for pioneering the European research on transparent electronics, demonstrating that oxide materials may be used as true semiconductors, which had a huge impact on the industry, but also making everything environmentally friendly, which we know it's a topic very dear to young people. She has won a list, an extremely long list of awards. I'll try to just to name a few. The Impact Award from the European, the Horizon Impact Award from the European Commission in 2020, Women in Engineering Award, Gold Medal for Human Rights. You were the former chief scientific advisor to the European Commission. So for the one of you involved in politics, you also know that this is important, not just for the inventor and innovation part, but also to shape a bit the policy side. So it's a big, big honor for me to have this opportunity to have this 30 minutes conversation. Thank you very much, Professor Fortunato, for joining us today. I'll go straight to the point. You spent major part of your career researching, contributing to European research, I mean, to worldwide research on transparent electronics, namely thin film transistor based on oxide semiconductor. What inspired you to become an inventor and to get into, you know, into this field?
Okay. Thank you very much for your nice introduction, and also I would like to acknowledge your invitation and to allow me to share with you and to the ones that are online to learn a little bit about what I'm doing here in around Lisbon in Portugal. I am an inventor, but as a first, I am an engineer. And as a material science engineer, I like very much to propose and to give solutions to the society and to some of the problems we are facing nowadays in terms of technology. And since I'm working on materials, one of the aspects or the driving forces in our laboratory is to work with sustainable materials. This is the key point. But since the beginning of the group, for 30 years, this is a key point. We work with materials. We want to use sustainable materials. And since we need to transform these materials either in a transistor, into a diagnostic test, into a real product, we are also taking into account the type of technologies that we are using. And again, the technologies that we are using are non-pollutant. We are looking for green technologies. So this is the two main aspects within our research group and also with the work I'm doing. First, work with sustainable materials. Second, try to use green technologies. And as you know, these thin film transistors and these metal oxides are used on transparent electronics. And this is quite easy to understand. Imagine to have in your car, in the window of your car, the GPS embedded in the glass. This is possible, is not yet done, but this is feasible. But this is possible because we are working with transparent materials. The materials at a macro scale are not transparent, but at the nanoscale, they are transparent. So this is why we are able to produce integrated circuits fully transparent. Nevertheless, this type of technology is already used by some companies. We had some years ago a work, a large contract with Samsung. Also, we share a patent with them. And for example, for each display that we are using in a mobile, into a television, or even at in a computer, these displays, the image has a lot of pixels, and each pixel is driven by a thin film transistor. So each pixel has behind it a transistor. And these transistors are based on these oxides, on these metal oxides. Instead of using silicon or amorphous silicon, that is the conventional semiconductor, we are substituting these conventional semiconductor by these new semiconductors based on metal oxides like zinc oxide and other materials. And this is already in place, especially for displays with a high resolution. And we are taking profit of the transparency, and in that way we can increase the resolution of the displays. So this is a direct application for what we are doing in terms of new materials and applications. But of course, since these new materials, they are semiconductors, we can exploit and we can use our imagination to apply these sensors, these integrated circuits in a wide range of different applications.
Thank you. That's extremely precise, and thank you for making the example. That definitely makes the whole thing more clear for, you know, for people watching this video. You just explained, not the paper-based microchip, and we know that has pushed through a generation of new sustainable, definitely recyclable device, also inexpensive, which, you know, these are three characteristics that are quite difficult to find together, and you manage to put this together, no? And this will play definitely a bigger role in the future of technology. In your view, if you think a bit about, you know, yourself as an inventor, how key are inventors for Europe to achieve a greener, more sustainable future? We know it's definitely one of the priorities, you know, not just the European Commission, but also the citizen, you know, that we make sure that Europe keeps its leadership when it comes to a sustainable future. How do you think, what is the role of inventors, and how do you think they are important in achieving this?
No, I guess we are playing, and we have a crucial role, the inventors, the scientists, we have a crucial role in proposing new solutions for the problems that we are facing now, especially related to the climate change, all the pollution and the emissions and so on. So we are playing a crucial role because we at the laboratory, we need to invent, we need to achieve new materials, new engineering processes, new synthesis, new chemical synthesis, and to try to transfer these new and green technologies to the industry, to the society. So I guess we have a crucial role. So nowadays, the universities, the research centers, they have a crucial role because they are forced to find solutions for the problems that we are facing now. And the European Commission, as you mentioned before, we have the Green Deal. We have also the 17 sustainable objectives from the United Nations. So we have also in place a lot of different tools, different mechanisms, also a lot of calls, and also we have projects, we have programs, and the European Commission is supporting programs for these specific problems. So we have the persons, we have the laboratories, we have the tools, we have the money from the projects. I guess all these problems are in our hands, and of course we need to solve them. And as I mentioned, we have a crucial role. We inside the universities and the research centers.
Do you're right now mentioned the European Commission, the budget we have, you know, all the know-how spread all over Europe, definitely, you know, your university is one of these definitely examples of this. Do you think the EU itself is doing enough to promote innovation, inventors, especially for the future generation? If you just focus on the inventors part, no, and the young inventors. So, I don't know, think yourself when you were 18, 20, 22, and, you know, starting to get, as you said, I am an engineer, no? So the young engineer, do you think we are doing enough for them? And if not, what should we do more, or where we should look more?
Yes, I have two answers to this question. In fact, I guess we have a lot of, we have enough mechanisms. Sometimes what is missing is the communication about these mechanisms. So what I would like, and also one of my recommendations, is related to communication. Sometimes we, inside universities, at the society, startups, and so on, sometimes we are not aware about the mechanisms that the European Commission has put in place. So it's, of course, they are making a lot of communication, but in my opinion, is not yet enough. So we have, I guess, enough mechanisms, but sometimes we are not aware of these mechanisms because the information is not coming to us. And also from our side, sometimes it's difficult to find information that we don't know that exists. So for new information and new programs, we need to receive this information inside our mailbox, inside. I'm not using social media. I'm just using the internet and the email. But I guess the European Commission needs to communicate more, to inform more.
It's definitely something that we hear several times, no? This communication problems that we might have at political level in the European Commission, in Brussels, etc. Speaking to several inventors, and again, if you know, look at yourself, not just when you were young, but also today, we see several times the topic of intellectual property rights mentioned. It's something that it seems to be, you know, like a recurrent fil rouge that we hear. What do you think it's the role of IP as an inventor, the role of IP rights, especially, again, if we look at Europe and if we're talking now about European Commission, apart from the communication part, do you think that what do you think the European Commission should do when it comes to Europe intellectual property rights? Do you think they are important for inventors? Do you share this view as well?
Of course, this is important. The intellectual property is quite important. But for example, what we are missing, and also, for example, in Portugal, is the support. For example, I can give you some examples inside my laboratory. We have some patents. But in some cases, we need to pay and we need to support these patents through our own projects because we don't have strong support from our national bodies. And also sometimes, of course, some of the patents, they will not succeed. This is like that when we are patenting an idea or a product or a process. At this moment, we are aware, okay, we have the potential, we know the potential, but not the end of the story. But I guess what we need to have is more support from the intellectual property persons inside each country, and to see how important this idea is or not. We need to have a professional screening about the best ideas and the best innovations we can achieve in order to have a selection and after that a true investment, and also the selling, because when we have an idea and at the university or we have a patent, I cannot sell this to a company, because we don't have I know quite well to how to make a project, how to run an experiment. I'm a scientist, but the other part between the idea and the success of this idea until a product, I guess this is not well done, even at European level. We need to have between these two worlds, because these are two worlds, we need to have something in between. A strong, for example, I give you an example, and maybe this is not common in Portugal, maybe it is common in other countries in Portugal, but for example, at United States, sometimes it's when I have a lot of friends at United States, and sometimes it is usual for them to have more patents than papers. This is exactly the opposite here in Europe. We have much more papers than patents, because there is like that. And also they have a strong support from specific entities to support the payment and also the writing of the patents. It's common at the American universities to have, for example, the companies inside the universities. They work like... I don't know the term in English, but it's quite important not only to have doctors or PhD persons inside the companies, but it's also quite important to have the companies inside university. So in that way, we can perform joint patents between specific products and the industry. And in that way, it is easier to go through the channel and to send and to patent our idea, because you know that there is already a commercial interest for a specific company.
Totally. And I mean, we also be part of let's say more collaboration between the three actors, no? The company, the university or research center, and the political bodies. This is something that we also hear a lot, you know, these three trying to talk more and having more of this multidisciplinary approach to one part. And you mentioned the commercialization, that's key. You know, so from an inventor, when you move kind of towards a startup part, but if you look at the part before, now literally when you start to become an inventor, and if we think again about a bit of intellectual property rights, do you think the young generation are aware of the importance of patent, or the young inventors you see, the young engineer you meet at university as well, do they realize and there is still this feeling of importance of patents? Is it increasing compared to maybe 20, 30 years ago, or do you see it decreasing? What is the feeling you have at university?
No, I have the feeling they are aware, maybe not 100% aware. Maybe they need to have more mentoring or more even now but of course for the last 20 years the slope is quite positive, no doubts, we increase a lot. But for example, I can give you the example of my university here at Faculty of Science and Technology, also to try to decrease this gap between companies, universities and patents. Even we have now, in between the two semesters, we have some courses, and some courses related to entrepreneurship, how to exploit a patent, how to make a patent. So we are, since we are at Science and Technology, we are giving to the students these courses, and they are mandatory, they are not optional, just to let them know that how important this is and how it is possible to find the right institutes and the right persons, for example, to apply for a patent or something like that. So, and we are making these for the last all for the last 12 years. We started this new program 12 years ago here at my university, and I guess we are, I don't know if we have others also of the other university, they are they are making the same, but I don't know, but we start this 12 years ago, and this is quite positive for the students and even for us, and also for the companies, because we need to send the students for to make a short period at all these different companies, and we have a nice networking between all these areas.
Nice. And I like the idea that you stress this importance of collaborative approach, you know, not to work alone 20 times on the same topic. Before I move to the next question, I just want to remind the people watching us that they can ask you a question in the platform they're watching us. So just type in your question in the platform where you're seeing this webinar. And after my next question, then we will put the question up. So by all means, any interest you might have, please write your question. Elvira, you just mentioned, you know, again, university, young people, the importance of education. Do you think there is something that can be done, or an advice that you would give to even inspire more young people to become engineer, inventors today, to work in innovation, harness their imagination? Is something that you, if you could speak to a larger audience of young people, let's say teenager, and also before you make important choices for your life, do you think, what would you tell them somehow to inspire and to say, you know, inventors, they might not be in the spotlight today. That's what we're trying to do with our campaign and plenty of other initiatives, but why should you become an inventor?
As I mentioned, an inventor, it is not a profession like it is, but since you are working on science, since you are working on technology, of course, at the end of the day, what you are looking for is for a better solution. You want to improve a product, you want to increase the performance of a specific product, you want to replace a material for a sustainable material, you want to reduce the cost of some process, and everything is, I guess, is related to innovation. And in some way with the inventions, because, but also this is quite, this is particular in the area of applied sciences, applied research. Because as you know, we have more or less two worlds, even nowadays they are a little bit connected. You have fundamental research, you have applied research. I'm working more on applied research, and if you are working on applied research, in some way it is easier to invent or to find the solutions. You are not discovering something new, you are inventing, you are creating new things. So in my case, I like very much to create new devices or apply conventional materials to non-conventional applications, as it is the case of paper. We built the first paper transistor, and we are using paper. Again, is a renewable material. The cost is quite low, and we are using paper, cellulose, paper like this, for electronic applications. So this is also, this is related to paper electronics, and at the end, what we want to have, more sustainable electronics, recyclable electronics, in some way try to reduce, in some applications, the electronic waste, part of the problems that we are facing now. So this is a little bit my daylight.
Extremely fascinating. Thank you. Now, I ask our thinking team to put up a question so that we can see from the crowd if we have something coming up. This is from Gaia, who's watching us on Facebook. Looking back, would you have done anything differently throughout your career?
No. I guess exactly the same. I'm quite happy.
Great. This is always nice to hear. And I mean, as I said, I tried to read as many awards as I could in the 2 minutes presentation, but definitely by all means, if you people watching us, they Google your name, but there is an extensive list of achievement. And it's good to see, as you said, you started working on sustainability, environment, and these kind of things related to technology 30 years ago. You know, today, it's very much an important topic for everybody, but you were definitely a pioneer in this. So credit to that. Next question from Irene, who's watching us on YouTube. Good morning, Professor Fortunato. Did you ever feel like a hidden inventor? And do you think European inventors deserve more recognition?
This is difficult.
Honest reply.
This is difficult to say. I guess when I invent something is not to receive a lot of recognition. When I invent something or when I'm doing something new, when I'm proposing a specific solution, again, for a problem or for the improvement of a product, a transistor, whatever, I'm not looking always in terms of the recognition I will receive. I'm doing this because I like to do what I'm doing. This is a little bit like a passion. I like very much to do what I'm doing. But of course, when we receive some awards or when our work is recognized, of course, this is quite good. Everyone likes to receive a prize or to have the work recognized. But I don't have a precise question if European inventors deserve more recognition. I don't know.
Okay, and the next one, we still have 3 minutes. So, Giorgos, currently because of school closure, lack of access to digital infrastructure, many young people face limitation to their learning, especially in the rural areas. What would be your advice to the person that cannot easily access education and learning?
Yeah, this is a problem, especially for experimental work, for work that is necessary to be done inside the laboratories, because nowadays we have all these facilities in terms like we are having now. For example, this was not possible maybe 2 years ago to have this audience and to speak with you. But I guess the only possibility, if we cannot access to digital infrastructures, this is really a limitation because, for example, now what we cannot work for some periods using our main laboratories, and of course the other way is to use the digital infrastructures. If in some parts of the world, in some places, we don't have access to digital infrastructures, this is much more complicated. So the only way is to try to. But okay, nowadays with the mobile phones and with of course we are still some of. Okay, some persons are facing some problems, some lack in terms of the access. But I guess nowadays, in some places, we have always free internet or within the municipalities or within our public bodies.
But you say there are, I mean, for as difficult as it is, because a laboratory, it's a physical place, you say there are kind of digital laboratories or digital things that people can access and do experimental there. That's basically what you're...
Yes, now we have a lot of videos. Even we are teaching now. Now we are not teaching in remote, but during the pandemic, some months ago, we perform a lot of videos concerning the experimental classes. And of course, it's not the same thing to watch a video, but it's better than looking for a PowerPoint or for some text.
Totally.
We need to invent a little bit the way how we communicate. You see, again, invention is not only to make transistors or to make new processes. Also, inventing things is also, we need to invent the ways how we communicate.
And you are doing that extremely well. We're very cautious of time and respectful. So we said 11:45 and it is now 11:45. So I would get close to the end of this webinar. Just 20, 30 seconds, everything you can share on your current or future projects. Is there anything that you're working on at the moment that it's, you know, something, first of all, you can share, because we know some things are definitely a bit more secret, but is there something you can share so that our people watching are, you know, get a bit more curious and go check out?
I will add my email address, and some, if someone
absolutely
wants to share,
it's not gonna be public because it's in the private chat, but I will mention it and we'll make sure to put it in the comment of the video when we publish the video, so the team is aware. It's emf at fct.unl.pt.
Correct.
But we will have this email under the video in the comments from Think Young, obviously. There will be your email. So if anyone is interested, they can definitely write you about this. Elvira, thank you very, very much. It's been a great honor. Thank you for being available to participate in this webinar, but also last year when you were part of a book on the hidden inventors, and we know you very much in contact with our team and very much caring about what we do. So again, and also thank you very much, obviously, for all the work you've done and you're still doing on technology and sustainability together. That's definitely something the old world needs. I close the webinar here, thanking everyone who watched and thanking Ericsson, obviously, for the support. And we see each other with the third webinar in January.
So okay, it was a pleasure. Much. And a good new 2022.
Thank you very much, Elvira.
Okay, bye-bye.